Yeah, well, thank you. Our speaker tonight is from Island White Humanists, and I think and he's brought, as I said, some Island White Humanists with him, which is great. Peter Marchant, our speaker, graduated in ancient history from Manchester University, and he's been studying Christian origins for 25 years. He worked for the Council for British Archaeology, and he's given many talks to Island White Humanists. His book, Peter, A Skeptic's Guide to the Origins of Christianity, is available on Amazon, and he's brought just a couple of copies here tonight as well. I've already bought one, so they're going very quickly. If you want a copy tonight, you better be quick after the talk. The standard explanation of Christian origins is the so-called Big Bang Theory. A great man called Jesus started it all off, in particular by the spectacular feat of rising from the dead. Well, I think I just have this inkling that Peter's going to explode the Big Bang Theory tonight. So will you please give a big welcome to Peter Marchant.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and thank you for coming along to my talk. Just get used to it. And thank you for David Warden and the committee of Dorset Humanists for inviting me, and also to my colleagues for coming to support me, and particularly our chairman, Simon Bly, for arranging the transport. I'm not going to say anything about my book, really. You can ask me any questions if you have any further questions about it. I think I'll just go straight into the talk. Oh, I should also thank Bill Nally, a member of our society that isn't here, who jazzed up my very plain slides into something a bit more interesting. Well, the greatest story ever told, they say, the New Testament is, but I think it's the greatest compendium of detective stories ever placed on the wrong shelf in a library. The original authors were often given coded messages and using metaphor and allegory, so they weren't speaking plainly, they weren't talking literally a lot of the time. And the second reason why it's a collection of detective stories is that the proto-Catholic Church, the Orthodox and Catholic Church ancestors, were trying to enforce their opinions by excluding contrary opinions from a very early date. They were rewriting texts or excluding documents from the canon of scripture from the second century onwards. So there has been, you have to be a bit of a conspiracy theorist to be in this business, I'm afraid. I think I'll pass the litmus test of conspiracy theory because I'm sure Richard III was responsible for getting the princes in the tower. The mechanism by which that happened, we don't know. We can never know that. It's funny that David should mention the Big Bang because I got it almost in my first sentence. And he didn't know that I had. Apologists would have you believe that the Big Bang model of Christian origins, that is, initial purity belief being infiltrated by heresy, is the model. But I think the opposite is true. The process, in my view, is that you have a crystallization from a wide variety of beliefs into a single, or what they hoped to be a single belief, and by the Middle Ages it was pretty much so. So we have a tremendous variety of sects that are feeding into Christianity, and it isn't from the teaching of one man. It's impossible for the general reader today to understand most of the scriptures in their original meaning because the culture is just so different. It's 2,000 years different. Modern readings nearly always are remote from the original ones. And if you remember one thing about biblical interpretation, it's like this. Pollsters in a general election, they're like pollsters in a general election. The authors of scripture may seem to be talking about the past or the future, but the only thing they're really interested in is the here and now. And it's your vote that counts, and they'll say anything to get it. I'll just give a couple of small examples of how things are not quite what they seem. In John's Gospel, the author urges his audience to love one another. Well, this seems a very admirable sentiment. But actually, if you look at it, he's actually talking to other Christians to stop fighting. The bit missed off, love one another, is that you should be recognized as my followers. In other words, he's not talking about this as a general principle. He's talking about the squabbling among early Christians, and Christians seem to always squabble right from the earliest period until today. Another example, Jesus saying, love your enemies. Well, that's perhaps a bit more questionable, but I think Luke gives a little bit of explanation here which people don't normally realise. Luke adds that you may heap coals on them. Love your enemies, that you may heap coals on them. What does this mean? He's just been talking about vengeance is mine, saith the Lord. So what he's saying is that God, that you must not take vengeance against your enemies, because if you do so, then God's vengeance will be less. And God is a much more formidable avenger than you could ever be. So don't let your enemies off lightly by your feeble attempts at punishment. I sometimes think that the Gospels might be read better in the way that you read A Christmas Carol. It's an engaging story imparting deep human truths, but you don't come away from it believing in ghosts or in time travel. Right.
So many things to do.
Our first little detective story is going to be about the dating of our modern dating system. It's started by this person around about the early 6th century.
How do you pronounce his name, please?
Dionysius Exiguus, Dennis the Humble.
All right.
Yes, either Dennis the Little or Dennis the Humble, we don't know. And this picture could be anybody. He set the system which is known as the Anno Domini system. And if I happen to say AD, it means advancing dates. And if I happen to say BC, it means backward counting, but I try to do BC, BCE, and CE. That's what I try to be consistent with, but I mean, having done 40 or 50 years of the other way. So the start of the Common Era was founded on an actual historical event, I think, and not the birth of Jesus Christ, which we can't, the date of which we can't know. It's all contradictory. And I won't go into that now. I'm sure a lot of you know about the contradictions of the date of Jesus. Our date inherited from the Anno Domini system was devised by this person and was based on teachings of the early church fathers. And they, in their turn, were based on the book of Daniel, and particularly book 9. They believed that Daniel had the gift of prophecy, but it's more likely that Daniel had the knack of prophecy. And the knack of prophecy is to live after the events you prophesy and write in pretense from an earlier viewpoint. Kindly historians call this reverse construction. But Daniel, I chose the cheesiest picture of Daniel I could, but I think I'm being a bit unjust, really, because Daniel is apocalyptic literature. He pretended to live in the 6th century BCE, but he didn't know much about the kings who were living at that time. In fact, Belshazzar's feast, which probably most of you have heard of, Belshazzar was never king of Babylon. But Daniel thought so. And so we all think so. And also, it wasn't the people who conquered Babylon, it wasn't Darius the Mede, as Daniel tells you, but it was Cyrus the Persian. How could he not know that, living in that time frame? Actually, when he starts to prophesy about future centuries, he gets better. He gets more accurate. I think we can draw an inference from that. But the purpose of apocalyptic literature is to bolster the confidence of believers. And in fact, they were going through a very hard time in the early 2nd century BCE, because the Greek king was trying to impose Hellenistic culture. And he even forced the idols to be put up in the temple of pagan gods, and the sacrifice of swine in the Jewish temple. So they were going through a very difficult time, and there was a tremendous revolt, and initially it wasn't successful. You may have heard of the Maccabees. They were Jewish kings who actually managed to overthrow the Greek kings for a short time, for a few years. But that was the background. The idea of apocalyptic literature is you are saying, well, I know a lot about things, I can foretell the future, and I'm going to foretell that you are having difficult times, but you will get over them, and the golden future awaits you. Now, the actual historical date, which I think is the beginning of our era, is the date of the sack of the temple by the Romans, the sack of Jerusalem by the Romans in 70. We just need a few little building blocks to get this argument quite right. In fact, Jesus was regarded by early Christians as the third temple, even though he was a person. They regarded him as the third temple. In Mark 14:58, the Sanhedrin accused Jesus of saying, "He will tear down this temple made with hands, and in 3 days build another not made with hands." Jesus, early Christians thought, was the sacrifice that had previously been carried out in the temple. Whereas in the temple you sacrificed animals continually, with Jesus there was one sacrifice which had to be commemorated. So Jesus is the third temple. The first temple was destroyed by the Babylonians. The second temple was destroyed by the Romans, and the third temple is Jesus. So there's a 3rd century Christian writer called Tertullian who argued that for the temple destruction minus 70, that was the second year of Vespasian, 70, as Jesus' birthday. And 70 was used because it took 70 years to rebuild the first temple into the second temple. And so also 70 is a magic number. It's 1 degree in the great day of the procession of the across the horizon of the it escapes me. The signs of the zodiac. Also to see the number of ripeness in human life. So I think that that was the actual setting date for our era. Minus 70 was supposed to be the birth date of Jesus. So 70 minus brings us to the year 1, which is the beginning of our era. And it is fitting, I think, that the fall of the temple in 70 should have been the foundation date of our era, because it's one of the most important events in world history, not generally recognised as such, because it gave birth to 2 religions. It gave birth to Christianity and to Rabbinic Judaism. And by destroying the temple, the Romans had cut off these 2 religions from their roots and let them run free. And had that not been the case, I think history might have been quite different. The Roman brutality is in marked contrast to the treatment of the Persians, which we'll come to later on, which is much more subtle. I don't know if any of you have heard of this word. This is the method by which the New Testament and many Old Testament books were written. Basically, it's the formation of narrative through the recasting of stories from Scripture. Gospel writers nearly always use the Septuagint, the Greek translation of the Hebrew Scriptures, but it's not always a very accurate one. So the details of crucifixion are not obtained from oral reports, but from Psalm 22 and related texts, which the author never acknowledges. My God, why hast thou forsaken me? They're the opening words of that psalm, from which all the other details come. These are the last words of a character in a drama. Last words in real life are usually much more banal, like William Pitt the Youngest, "I think I could eat one of Bellamy's meat pies." The purpose of Midrash was not simply to copy past stories, but to improve them, that is, emulation, exaggeration, reverse them, or some other form of spin. So the feeding of the 5,000 men with 7 loaves shows that Jesus has much more powerful mojo than Elijah, Elisha rather, who in 2 Kings with 20 loaves could only manage to feed a mere 100 men. In that story, there's also a reminder about how the Gospels are structured. They're little tiny sort of narrative units called pericopes. And they're all strung together because a couple of chapters on, we have another feeding, a feeding of the 4,000. And in the second story, why don't the disciples say, just do that thing you did before, Master? But of course, they just reenact the same rigmarole of incomprehension. So Haggadah is the recasting of narrative. Other types of Midrash is reinterpretation of the law, like the Sermon on the Mount, and recasting of sermons, including Stephen's very long sermon on the point of death. It goes on for about half an hour in Acts of the Apostles. Right, not much regard is given to classical influences. In fact, they were hardly recognised until about 30 years ago. Mimesis is the most important one, that's imitation, and the works of Homer particularly are relevant. And I'm going to concentrate now on the works of Homer. Now, a hypotext is a text from which an idea comes, and the hypertext is the receiving text, which is the reworking of the hypotext. But I won't be using those words very much. There are literary forms, chiasmus, inclusio, and others. I should just mention a little bit about those. And the philosophies, cynicism, stoicism, Platonism. Jesus speaks like a cynic and dies like a stoic. I'm going to concentrate a bit on mimesis, and as I say, it's only about 30 years ago that Dennis R. MacDonald was doing some research on a non-canonic New Testament book, and he noticed that there were some correspondences with Homer, the works of Homer. Homer is poetry and these books are prose, that's a big difference, but some of the ideas he found rather compelling, and he went on to look at Mark's Gospel and all the Gospels. So I've now listed some correspondences between the story of Odysseus and the story of Jesus. I think we can agree on that one. Mm-hmm. Odysseus actually built his own ship at one point. Yeah, I think
we could just read them in case people look back can't see the screen very clearly.
Okay. So the second one, he was a technoman, a skilled craftsman, and so was Jesus. So what I say for one goes for the other. They both travelled with uncomprehending companions. The companions are tested and fail. Undertook many sea voyages. This is interesting because the Sea of Galilee is only 4 by 7 miles. And yet, to read Mark's Gospel, you'd think it was a huge, great sea. In fact, at one point, Mark refers to on the night watch, something happening on the ninth watch. That would be many hours into a sea journey. The origin is not from the story, it's almost certainly from the Mediterranean, from Odysseus. And number six, often travelled incognito. Yes, Odysseus had to travel incognito because he angered Poseidon, and also when he reached Ithaca, he was also having to be in disguise because his house had been taken over by the suitors of his wife. This monster in a cave. I don't suppose many people think that there was a monster in a cave in the New Testament, but actually there is. Dennis R. MacDonald's chapter on this is quite convincing. The demoniac of Gadara is a frightening character. He's so strong that no man can actually, or no men can restrain him. And he lives in caves, tombs, which would be caves. And at the end of Jesus' miracle, the transmigration of the demons into a herd of swine recapitulates the story of Circe, the witch, turning Odysseus, his companions, into a herd of swine. So it also comes from the Odyssey.
Yeah, they both
return to home, to a home infested with murderous rivals. But if you think of Jerusalem and the temples being Jesus' spiritual home, that figures. A wise woman anoints him. Yes, this is very interesting. In the Odyssey, it's Euryclea, his old nurse, who on bathing the feet, his feet, she recognises, even though he's in disguise, she thinks he's an elderly vagrant, but she recognises the scar on the ankle of her long-lost master. An unnamed woman anoints Jesus' head with costly oil in the house of Simon the leper, and is promised far-flung fame when the gospel will be preached. The meaning of Euryclea, the name of the nurse, is far-flung fame. This represents, I think, a midrash of reversal and emulation. One, the head is anointed instead of the feet in one story, costly ointment instead of water, prostitute stories. A sign is given to Odysseus' servant, but no sign is given to the woman in Mark's gospel. She acts on faith alone. To me, this is a clear sign of emulation. Yeah, they both return from Hades alive, because Odysseus had to go to Hades to ask various people how to get home. When we get to the Passion of Christ, we have a different character, the most tragic character really in the whole of the Iliad, Homer's other work, and that is Hector. Hector, who has to die by Achilles' hand. Hector's death and his killer were known to the reader by his own prediction, and Jesus' death and his killer's known by prophecy. Hector's troops had fled for safety into the city. Jesus' followers had fled for safety from the city. The upshot was they were both left alone. Zeus had decided on Hector's death, and Yahweh had decided on Jesus' death. It says in Acts and in the Epistle to the Romans that by God's definite plan, Jesus died. Hector and Achilles trade taunts. Jesus' oppressors taunt him, but he is silent, obviously superior. Hector calls on his brother for help. This is a subtle use of emulation. Hector calls, but Jesus is misunderstood as calling on Elijah for help, when he is actually quoting Psalm 22, calling on God by an alternative name, El, E-L. So it's a highly revealing section, this, because although the bystanders are supposed to be Jews, they do not understand Aramaic. That's their own language. Hence we can be sure that the evangelist is addressing Greek-speaking Jews of Mark's locality outside Judea, not Jews. Hector's soul went to Hades, and Jesus uttered a loud cry and expired. The Trojans mourned and foresaw their city would be destroyed from top to bottom. And in the Gospel, that same phrase, from top to bottom, is used at the same point of the story. That is an actual sort of verbal correspondence. And I think Mark was avoiding specific verbal correspondences in many cases, but this one he didn't. Achilles gloated. Have I said anything about Achilles gloated? No, I haven't. That's quite difficult to... MacDonald thinks that the centurion's comment, truly this man is the son of God, is sarcasm, and is therefore lined up with Achilles' gloat. I don't agree with him here, actually. I think we have in Mark an example of reversal and the centurion is expressing awe and regret at his killing of the Son of God. This is a direct reversal of Achilles' behavior. Point nine, the woman of Troy, led by Hecuba, mother, Andromache, wife, and Helen, femme fatale, witness Hector's death. Now, the three women selected by Mark are Mary Magdalene, possibly wife, Mary, mother of James and Joseph, Jesus' mother probably, because early in Mark's Gospel, he's shown to have brothers, James and Joseph. So they probably left out Jesus for some reason. And then Salome, femme fatale possibly. Although in Mark's Gospel, Salome is not named, it's just daughter of Herodias. Anyway, I'll just deal with these one at a time. I think the Andromache, Mary Magdalene, an interesting point actually that I came up with quite recently, that in Aramaic, Magdala, which could be the origin of this name, means the hairdresser. And a hairdresser was a euphemism for a brothel keeper. And we know that she originally had a reputation, so perhaps she's Maria the hairdresser. In this book, this translation of the New Testament has her as Maria the hairdresser, and it's really quite amusing. Seeing what Mary the hairdresser is doing.
Do you think they should rename the Oxford or Cambridge College?
Yes, she is the wife character, if there is one, which she calls her master Rabboni in John's Gospel, and that is how a wife would address her husband. As for Helen Salome, that's a bit tenuous, I think, really, that connection, but maybe something. Hector's corpse was protected from defilement by Apollo. Jesus' corpse protected from defilement by early death. Father Priam begs Achilles to return the corpse for honourable burial. Father substitute Joseph begs Pilate to return the corpse for honourable burial. Corpse retrieved at nightfall. Corpse anointed by women, corpse to be anointed by women. Now this is a bit strange because in Hellenistic culture it was normal for women to prepare corpses of either sex, but in Jewish culture it was most certainly not. John's Gospel seeks to correct this by having Joseph and Nicodemus prepare the body for burial. Thus this text in Mark is culturally incoherent. Well, did they return from Hades? The Gospels clearly said that Jesus did. Now, I'm going on to another form of Greek influence now. This is chiasmus. It's like an onion effect. If you cut an onion down the middle, you will get a chiasmus effect. And you'll see what happens. Now, this is the Gospel of Matthew, and it's split into narrative units. So, genealogy, Mary and an angel, gifts of wealth at birth, flight to Egypt, Judea avoided, baptism of Jesus, crossing of the sea twice, John's ministry, that's John the Baptist, rejection of Jesus, secrets revealed through Jesus, attack of the Pharisees. Pharisees determined, I can't read here, to kill God's servant. Now notice what happens. Condemnation of Pharisees matches the K. If you look at the J's, they match. And the I's, rejection of Jesus. John's death, John's ministry. Crossing the seas. Transfiguration matches the baptism, because on both occasions you have a voice from heaven saying more or less the same thing, that seems to be. Judea entered and not avoided this time. This is absolutely crucial change. March on Jerusalem. Gift of wealth at death. That is the tomb of a rich man. And Mary and an angel are involved at the visitation to the tomb. And commission summary of future times compared with the genealogy summary of past times. So these chiasmuses operate in most of the Gospels, and in John's Gospel too, but it's been chopped up, John's Gospel, so you can't really get the main pattern of it anymore. But there are also smaller chiasmuses within shorter stories. I want to say just a word about Persian influences. I mentioned the brutality of the Romans and the way they treated after the fall of Jerusalem. They more or less flattened the temple and ejected most of the inhabitants of Jerusalem. The Persians admittedly didn't conquer the Jews, they conquered the conquerors of the Jews, and they took over from the Babylonians. But they were very very subtle in their way that they treated their subject races. They encouraged the Jews to return to Jerusalem eventually and rebuild the temple. But having been ensured that the type of religion that the Jews would practice would be more in line with their own religion. So the 60 or 70 years that the Jews were, or the educated Jews, were under the Persian influence, the Persians put that to good effect. And so Judaism was a completely different animal after the years with the Persians. So these changes occurred. Dualism, good God versus evil God. Well, in later Judaism and Christianity, we do in fact have Satan, who can be seen as the evil God. Coming up an end time deliverer, they called it the Sarashind. There was no idea in Judaism of an end time deliverer. There was a Messiah, the idea of a Messiah, but the Messiah was an earthly person, a king, a descendant of David, somebody who would live and die, but would just be a military victor who would restore Israel's power. It wasn't a divine being, but the Persian version was a divine being. Last judgment doesn't exist in Judaism until the time of the Persians, so they imported that, and of course it comes straight into Christianity. And so does this idea of the lake of fire, wicked to be consumed, the good to inherit the earth, and immortality of the soul. It doesn't belong in Judaism at all. But of course it does in Christianity. The world and the heavens populated by angels and demons. In the New Testament, it's absolutely full of demons and demons being cast out. In the Old Testament, there are hardly any demons at all. And if they are, they're very much in the later writings. The dating in the New Testament, these are the traditional dates of the New Testament. I think these are very wrong. I'm thinking the dates are in the 2nd century. So if you say the life of Jesus ended around about 30, we're talking about 100 years probably before the Gospels are written. I'll just say a few things about this. It's a bit complicated, so I should cut it down as much as I can. Terminus Antiquum is the latest possible dating of the Gospel, so this is relatively easy because Irenaeus, Bishop of Lyon, who was writing in the 180s CE, seemed to have been the mastermind of the whole of the traditional canon. He was the first one to name the Gospels. They originally had no authors, but he quoted the first lines on them, so we know these are the actual Gospels he's talking about. And there's really very little evidence for any Gospels before the second half of the 2nd century. I think I'll go on to this person. He's Martin of Sinope, was the first person to actually try and build up a canon of scripture, that is, approved scriptures. Nobody had done that up to then. Now, he was the sort of Aristotle Onassis of the ancient world. He made a lot of money in shipping, and he was also a bishop, so his father was a bishop too, obviously in the same sense. And he had a lot of ideas about Christianity, and he came from the Black Sea to Rome with a huge amount of money. And they accepted it gladly initially, but when they got to find out his ideas, they returned it to him. Because they clustered the Marcion's gospel, and these are the main points which I'll just go through briefly. You believe that the God of the Old Testament, the creator God, was not the same God who had sent Jesus. And that unknown God was referred to as the Father. And if you happen to be reading the Bible, and when you get to passages mentioning the Father, it is probably the Marcionite God. Whereas the Jewish God was vengeful, the Father was forgiving. With the Father there would be no last judgment. The death of Jesus was not for man's sin, but for the price to purchase the souls of Yahweh's creations for the Father. There was no doubt that Yahweh had created mankind, but a ransom would have to be paid. Therefore, Christianity was a religion quite separate from Judaism. So Marcion was trying to cut down the Jewish influence on Christianity, more or less cut it loose, cut it completely adrift. We don't know what Marcion's gospel was exactly. We're told by later Catholic writers, writing about 70 years later, that he had a version of the Gospel of Mark which he cut down, and 10 letters of Paul, which had been unknown until then. So Tertullian, writing in the 220s, claimed that Marcion's Luke was a version stripped of his Jewish connections. But critical scholars are well aware that the opposite might be the case, and that Catholic redactors or editors got hold of Marcion's gospel and Judaized it. I'm just going to read one, if I can find it. I'm going to read you one little parable which I think illustrates that it may be the Catholics got hold of it and put Judaism into it rather than it wasn't there originally. This is a little parable about something old and something new. Well, the new thing being referred to is Christianity, and the old thing being referred to is Judaism. This is Robert Price's translation, which is quite informal. Look, no one is so stupid that he cuts a patch from a new garment to cover the hole in the old one. Otherwise, the new section will shrink with washing and tear away, and the patch from the new one will not agree with the old. And now this next bit. Notice particularly the last sentence. And no one fills old wineskins with new wine. Otherwise, when the new wine ferments, it will burst the taut skins. The wine will be spilled and the skins destroyed. But one must put new wine into new skins. And no one accustomed to vintage wine wants the new, for he thinks the old is good. Now to me, that is an absolute giveaway that somebody has tacked on something to Marcion's gospel. So I think the claim that Marcion stripped down Luke's gospel is very much open to question. Also, yes, the prodigal son sounds rather like a Marcionite story because it proposes a more humane method of dealing with an errant son, and that suggests in Deuteronomy where you're advised to drag your son into the village square for communal stoning.
It's much more effective.
Now, the town is post-quem.
I must go back.
Turn this post down on the bottom of the page there. Establishes a date before which a gospel could not have been written. And Christian scholars mostly try and put this as far near the date of 70 CE as possible. They slam it up to, they agree that the date of 70 must be the earliest possible date, and then they slam up their model completely up against 70. So some will say that Mark was written in 70, and then the others are calculated, as I said in the earlier slide. But there's no evidence to justify the early date at all. The model is justified on a single piece of so-called evidence that there are sayings of Jesus in all the Gospels in which he prophesies that they will see the Son of Man coming in glory before some of his followers have tasted death. The only gospel, so the Christian scholars say, oh well, it must have been within the lifetime of people who actually knew Jesus. But I think this is a completely wrong way of looking at things. To understand the meaning of these passages, we need to know the principle of form criticism. This entails a way of reading the Gospels as discovered by the great German theologians Strauss, Bauer, Walter Bauer, and Rudolf Bultmann. Form criticism, it's not really too difficult, proposes that the teachings and actions of Jesus are not historic tradition from the time of Jesus, but are instruction from church leaders to members of their own communities at the time of the Gospel's composition. The figure of Jesus, therefore, acts as a mouthpiece for doctrine, and his actions provide an example for early missionaries to follow. It is clear that the gospel writers were church leaders in their own right. The correctness of the form critical approach is underlined by the continual failure of the disciples to understand Jesus, his message and his actions. If they so radically and repeatedly misunderstood him, how is it that the message was ever transmitted? They are the fall guys placed there to show how not to do things. They embody the anticipated scepticism of the reader. The story of doubting Thomas actually spells it out rather clearly. Hence, Jesus saying that some of his followers will not taste death until he comes must be seen by the form critic to have no relevance to chronology and must be understood as an address to the first hearers of the gospel. This is underlined by the fact that all the Gospels contain a passage about the manifestation of Jesus' glory, irrespective of their date of composition, even into the second century with Thomas's Gospel. And there's always an accompanying mitigating text along with this prophecy, along the lines of, do not ask the exact time and the Father will decide. And it must be no coincidence that Mark inserts after this prophecy the transfiguration scene, where Christ is actually seen in his glory. So Peter, James and John, who have been taken aside from the others, at least they do see Jesus in glory, so he's kept his promise. So how it can be used to date the Gospels, I have no idea. So the end times will be revealed, not before the last of Jesus' disciples is dead, but before the last of the gospel readers is dead. Thus fulfillment is indefinitely postponed, which is the situation Christians find themselves in to this very day, and they're stringing it out even now. I'm going to skip Paul, unfortunately. Also, I say that Paul is mainly dated in the second century. At least the versions of Paul that we have are basically second century in date. Now, this I call Jesus hiding in plain sight. There are mentions of Jesus in Josephus's books, The Wars of the Jews and Jewish Antiquities, but they are interpolations. And my book describes in quite great detail why we must see them as interpolations. The first of these characters, Jesus, son of Ananias, is a particularly interesting case. He has sort of been overlooked. Now look at all this text. You can't possibly read this. But I think I'm going to have to read it to you. And I want you to take note of, if you know much about the passion story of Jesus, I imagine most of you are brought up Christians, you'll know a bit about the passion story of Jesus, and I want you to note the parallels as I go along. An incident more alarming still occurred 4 years before the war, 62 CE. One Jesus, son of Ananias, a very ordinary fellow, came to the feast at which every Jew is supposed to set up a tabernacle for God. As he stood in the temple, he suddenly began to shout, a voice from the east, a voice from the west, a voice from the four winds, a voice against Jerusalem and the sanctuary, a voice against the bridegrooms and brides, a voice against the whole people. Day and night he uttered this cry as he went through all the streets. Some of the more prominent citizens, very annoyed at these ominous words, laid hold of the fellow and beat him savagely. Without saying a word in his own defence, or for the private information of the persecutors, he persisted in shouting the same warnings before. The Jewish authorities, rightly concluding that some supernatural force was responsible for this man's behaviour, took him before mournful tones, answered every blow with woe to Jerusalem. When Albinus, for that was the procurator's name, demanded to know who he was, where he came from, and why he uttered such cries, he made no reply to the questions, but endlessly repeated his lament over the city, until Albinus decided he was a madman and released him. Those who daily cursed him, he never cursed. Those who gave him food, he never thanked. For 7 years and 5 months he went on unceasingly, till during the siege, that's 70, after seeing the fulfillment of the foreboding, he was silent. He was going round on the wall, uttering his piercing cry, and as he uttered a last word, "And woe to me also," a stone shot from an engine struck him, killing him instantly. That would have been a very large stone, actually, which may have significance. Now, I don't know how many of these you notice, but he was named Jesus. Named Jesus, a husbandman, that would be one translation of the fellow, attended a sacred feast, preached in the temple, quoting Jeremiah, predicted the fall of Jerusalem, predicted the destruction of the temple sanctuary, predicted the defeat of the Jews, arrested by the Jews for his preaching, offered no resistance or word of defence, beaten by the Jews, taken before the Roman procurator, interrogated by the Roman procurator, asked to identify himself but refuses, scourged by the Romans, found without fault by the Roman governor, who decides to release him. Those who daily cursed him, he never cursed. Those who were good to him, he never thanked. Predicted his own death, killed by the Romans, death associated with a large stone. Am I pushing up a bit too far? I don't know. I'll get back to that. I think I can't make any more comments about Jesus, Son of Man, and Rise. I'll just say that on the internet, I noticed some Christian apologists have gone on and said, "Oh, so there are 21 likenesses between Jesus, Son of Ananias, and Jesus of Nazareth." Well, if you compare the two presidents, Lincoln and Kennedy, I've noticed 50 likenesses between them. They were both succeeded by President Johnson. They were both assassinated. But of course, there are mountains and mountains of evidence about those people. Libraries full of evidence about both those presidents. And of course, you can find any number of likenesses, but we only have this tiny little bit of evidence. About 70% of the whole text is obviously used in the story of Jesus' passion. Well, I think it is. So I think this is one of the Jesus, Son of Ananias, is one of the characters used to formulate the Jesus narrative. And this is another one. I've only really just got into this one. Judas of Galilee was a Messiah figure. He was active in the first third of the first century, so he was just a generation, or even less than a generation before Jesus. All the things they have in common with Jesus. They both survived the massacre of the innocents. Herod actually locked up a lot of people. When Herod was dying, he realized people were getting ready to celebrate, so he ordered that all the main families, somebody should be seized from them and thrown into jail and executed at the time of Herod's death. And Judas of Galilee was one of these. But his successor, luckily, when Herod died, let them all out. But there was going to be a massacre of innocents. They said God was the reigning ruler and Lord, connected to Sepphoris and Nazareth. Sepphoris is only about 3 miles from Nazareth, and Nazareth didn't really exist at the time of Jesus, but I won't go into that.
They both cleansed the temple in different ways. They both had zealots, these were the extreme nationalists, and Sicarii was another name among their followers. We know that Jesus had Simon the Zealot and Judas Iscariot was probably Sicarii, from the Sicarii. They both marched on Jerusalem in their own way, crucified with fellow insurgents, settled in Galilee to avoid the successor of Herod. They both did that. Despised family relationships. In Luke it says, unless you hate your mother, father, etc., etc., you cannot be my follower. They're both avid for the law, opposed to Roman taxation. In fact, in Luke's gospel it says that on the charge sheet against Jesus, that was he encouraged people not to pay taxes to the Romans. We don't hear about it in any other gospel. They both proclaim Messiah, questioned by Herod. The last one, were both crucified with a title above their heads. Well, now that is my speculation. But the interesting point about this Judas of Galilee, in Josephus' books, his narrative has been removed in a lot of places. We know this because there are references to his sons, who were both, three of his sons were executed by the Romans. And it harks back to, as I said earlier in my book, or in another book, but these references no longer exist, so they have been removed by Christian interpreters, by Christian editors, I would guess. I'll cut to the chase here and I'll go to the final element here. This account of Judas Galilean, I think he is actually one of the basic characters used to form the character of Jesus. I'm beginning to see Jesus as something of a recipe. You can add a bit of this person, a bit of that, and I think the congruences between the stories of these people, Jesus' son Ananias and Judas the Galilean, are just too close. And actually there is what I call a smoking gun in the middle of all this. The crucifixion of Judas of Galilee was almost certainly covered by Josephus in the Jewish War and Antiquities of the Jews. As I said, the sections relating to his death have been removed by Christian scribes. In fact, everything's been removed in the years when he was active, apart from his early years. But it's known that there were mentions of him and quite detailed ones from what is said about his sons. But why were they removed? Because the parallels were uncomfortably close. And I thought for some time, it seems very odd in the creeds, and particularly the Nicene Creed, that you have only one historical character mentioned, and that is Pontius Pilate. Suffered under Pontius Pilate. It says nothing about what Jesus said, nothing about his miracles, you don't have to believe any of that, but you must believe that he suffered under Pontius Pilate. This seems very strange. And actually Eusebius, early church historian, crony of the Emperor Constantine, gives it away, really. I'm just going to read an extract from his Ecclesiastical History. The historian already mentioned, Josephus, in the 18th book of his Antiquities, says about the 12th year of the reign of Tiberius, that's 26, Pontius Pilate was entrusted with the government of Judea, and there he remained full 10 years, almost until the death of Tiberius. Accordingly, the forgery of those who have recently given currency against our Saviour is clearly proved, for the very date given in them shows the falsehood of their fabrications, for the things they have dared to say concerning the passion of the Saviour are put in the fourth consulship of Tiberius, which occurred in the seventh year of his reign, 21 CE, at which time it is plain that Pilate was not yet ruling in Judea. If the testimony of Josephus is to be believed, it clearly shows in the above-mentioned work that Pilate was made procurator of Judea in the 12th year of his reign. So Eusebius is the man who masterminded the creed. He was actually at the Council of Nicaea, and he's put this Pilate thing to draw away the attention from the earlier time frame that some of the character of Jesus is based on, that is the Judas of Galilee.
that is the way I'm thinking at the moment, and I'm still working on it. I think that's.
We're going to have an exam now. You're all going to be tested on various points of the talk, so I hope you are paying attention. I found this. I'm going to go to the microphone. I found this fascinating, Peter. I did biblical scholarship at Kent University 30 years ago. They didn't tell us any of this. but maybe I wasn't paying attention. I learnt tonight how to pronounce a particular word. I've been mispronouncing it for 30 years. Don't know if you remember
it.
Well, it might be you, or it might, yeah, I don't know, but for 30 years I've been talking about pericopes, which are those, which are those little sort of nuggets of the story. And you said it's pericope, so I think you're probably right. I'm glad I wasn't giving the talk. You're talking about pericopes, and then people thinking, well, he doesn't know how to pronounce it.
I would say it wrong. Yeah.
One of the references again that you put in the start of the talk, Peter, was something that I found really quite explosive to my belief in Jesus as a historical person. It's when you realise that that very famous saying on the cross, my God, why hast thou forsaken me, is a direct quotation from Psalm 22. And you think, hang on a minute, if someone's dying on a cross, they wouldn't just sort of quote from scripture. Christians probably would say that he would, but it doesn't kind of ring true. So that was an interesting one. Well, I could make lots of other points, but I'll stop wittering and open the floor to any questions that you have. Dean is first. Simon's got the mic. Dean.
Yeah, hi. It's very interesting. It's a quick question, actually. It's just about when you said the dating of Paul. You said Paul was 7th century.
Yeah.
Obviously, that'd be a lot different from what a lot of apologists would say.
Absolutely. You know, everything I say is very different from what apologists say.
So, I'll try to get really close on showing you the crucifixion, that sort of stuff. So, when you say 2nd century, what's your thinking for why 2nd century? You said it was written. Paul was there. Well, you said there wasn't Paul, I suppose. And also, you said...
Maybe.
So, why are you saying 2nd century?
Well, there are many, many reasons. One of them is that Tertullian said that Marcion discovered the Epistle to the Galatians. Now, Marcion has been working 140 to 160, and he discovered, he may have written it. And nobody really knows about the Epistle of Paul until the 2nd century. We have no reference at all to them existing in the 1st century. Of course, the story is written that they do belong to an early date to add to their veracity. And probably... I think 1 Corinthians has probably got a core of an early date in it, and Romans, a little bit of 2 Corinthians, maybe a bit of Galatians, but past that, you're really well into the 2nd century. The whole idea is they show that you have a church, and they use words that will never be used. I think Christianity was a branch of Judaism for a good 50 years and wasn't split away from Judaism until the 80s, I think, the late 80s.
Do you think that, the date of the Gospels was later than suggests?
Yeah.
So do you think Paul, would the Gospels have been written, do you think, prior? Would Paul be aware of the Gospels, or were they later?
No, I think Paul was written prior to the Gospels.
Yes.
Yeah. I think both their dates need to be pushed back.
So they shift a whole lot.
Yeah.
Okay.
Any more questions? Don't be shy. See if I've got
You said at one point, Peter, Jesus speaks like a cynic and dies like a stoic, which was a great quotation. Could you say a bit more about that?
Yes. The words of Jesus are completely contradictory throughout the scriptures. They come from different sources. He speaks in completely opposite ways. So he's a constructed figure, I think, and he says what the authors wanted to say at a particular moment. And he can be tremendously vengeful at one moment, and then he can be philosophical the next. He can be quite Jewish, then he can be quite Greek. It's all things to all men. That is the attraction of Jesus, I think.
Yeah. What were the particular things that he said that were like this, the cynic philosophy?
Like the cynic philosophy, it's all stuff about take no thought for the body, all those sayings. That part of Matthew's gospel is a lot of cynicism. Diogenes living in a barrel, isn't it? Very simple life.
Thank you.
If you're saying that Paul took it, wasn't written until the year 200.
Oh, I didn't say that.
Well, what were you saying then?
I said 2nd century.
Well,
that's
see.
Beginning 100.
Oh, the year 100
yeah.
Then. Okay. So in that case then, when was Paul alive, or did Paul actually exist, or was it written by somebody and given the name Paul?
I think Paul was an authority figure, and a lot of people attached writings to his name. Some of the writings may be original, and some of them may go into the first century, but it's almost impossible to find out which are which.
So do you think Paul was a real historical figure, or is it impossible to say?
It's hard to say, but I think on balance, probably yes. But not the Paul that you read from the epistles, because there's just so much overlay.
And you think perhaps Marcion was the person who wrote a lot of what we now consider to be Paul's epistles?
He might have written the Gospel of Luke, or an early version of it.
What
we
do you
don't know of any earlier mention of the Gospel.
Okay. What do you think of the speculation that Luke's Gospel was written by a woman?
I don't think I'd heard of that, actually. What do you know?
I was hoping you'd know all about it, because I can't remember much about it either. But
it's immaterial whether it was a man or a woman.
Maybe it is, but I have read several years ago that was one particular theory. Anyway, never mind. Let's get to our next question.
I think it's unlikely, actually.
Okay. Aaron.
Hello. You mentioned Jesus being like a recipe, which I took from that he didn't actually exist, and there was little bits of this and bits of that, bits of that. However, you've done the research, so would you, in your opinion, did he really exist?
No. In my opinion, he didn't. I mean, we can't be sure, but everything points to the fact that he's an amalgamation of what everybody wants him to be. So that is why perhaps he's so effective today, because whatever you want from Jesus, you take from him, because it's all there.
Are you familiar with Richard Baucom's Jesus and the Eyewitnesses? And I think it was in What Are the Gospels, which I think was possibly by Charles Talbot.
I've heard of the name, but I've not read the book.
These seem to be the two books that most Christians go to for evidence that Jesus was a real person, and that the Gospels are Greco-Roman biography. And I wonder if you have any thoughts on that. Obviously,
I haven't read either of those books. No. By, you know, I see on YouTube a lot of apologetic stuff, and so I don't think much of the arguments of those people from what I've seen on them, but I don't think I would read a book like that, because it starts out with an agenda.
I mean, certainly Richard Baucom does seem to be he started out as a diehard Christian, and I think he's going to go out that way as well. So he's a lot of confirmation bias there.
Mm.
Well, you know, the cultural overlay of Christianity is absolutely massive, and it affects everything. It affects the translations of the scriptures, which even now, I mean, do many people realise that there's no such word as crucify or crucifixion or cross in the Bible? There isn't. It's the word staros, meaning stake. There's lots of things like this which are just read back into the original books, so that later doctrine is projected backwards.
The Jehovah's Witnesses know that. That's why they actually, one of their teachings is that Jesus was not crucified, but actually executed on a stake. It's one of their points of doctrine.
Yes.
They get
stop
right
there, isn't it?
So they stop there.
Could you just explain a little bit more about the word chiasmus? Was that the right word?
Oh, yes, chiasmus is it's like an onion layer. And these operate either on a small scale in small stories or for the whole gospel, as you see in Matthew. So that the outer layers match and the inner layers. There's one central episode, usually, and it was the plot of the Pharisees in the Gospel.
So it's almost as if the literary construction.
Absolutely. It's nothing to do with reality,
yeah,
to do with history. It's a theological creation, and the Gospels are theological books. They aren't history. They're made to sound like history. Now, unfortunately, 90% of people take them as history, but they're not history at all.
Do you think the original author, say Mark, for example, do you think when he was writing it, he knew full well he wasn't writing history, or did he think he was inspired by the Holy Spirit writing history, or did he know that he was writing
allegory? He was writing an allegory, yes, I think he was. And Mark is the only really important writer in the New Testament as far as the story of Jesus is concerned, because everybody else copied him. I mean, it's known that 90% of Mark has gone straight into Matthew, 65% has gone straight into Luke, all the narrative stuff, and even John. You can tell where John has used the synoptic tradition of the other three in the story, in the Passion story, for example. I'll just give you one example, and that is the betrayal of Jesus by Peter. That's me. And the story of Jesus going to trial and it being broken by the story of Peter betraying Jesus three times. The story of Jesus' trial is broken in exactly the same place. Can't be coincidence. Why would you break the story at all? Well, you're breaking the story because you're contrasting Jesus' great faith and strength with Peter's weakness in a much lesser trial.
No.
We've got lots of fictional ideas in our lives, Enid Blyton and various others, Lord of the Rings.
Mm-hmm.
In your looking back at historical documents of the people of that time, I'm guessing they must have written fictional documents about mythical people as we do now.
Yeah.
Looking back at those, how would you distinguish between a realistic mythical person they were writing against to make a story, rather than the historical fact that about one they thought was actual belief? Could you just tell the difference?
Well, that is the great skill of Mark's gospel, that it's very difficult to tell the difference. Yeah, we know quite a few Hellenistic novels, but Mark was actually a genius, I think, the gospel, the writer, we don't know what his name was, we don't know the writers of any of the gospels doing this. But that is the foundational document. All the other gospels depend on them. And it's a new genre, really, that he brought into being. And that's part of the genius. And that's part of the power of it. You can't say that it's fiction. You assume it's fact. Does that sort of answer your question?
You mentioned somebody who was the first person to put the books of the Bible together.
Yeah, Marcy.
He would have been looking at all these works of written articles by various people, and he would have looked at some which would have sounded mythical and magical and all sorts of things. So his judgment picked out the ones he thought was genuine, I'm guessing, and he put them together.
Yeah, I'm thinking of Marcion. Well, Marcion, the reason why he was declared a heretic was
that he believed that Jesus was a spirit coming down to earth and then inhabited a body and then left the body. Docetism, it's called. And so he was really wanted to conform to that particular doctrine. So anything that didn't fit in with that doctrine, he would put aside. But I think there was probably only one gospel around at that time. But they probably weren't circulating very widely, maybe in certain areas. They were very limited to certain areas. I think the gospels are not really known until the last quarter of the second century. We don't have any definite reason to know their existence until then. Certainly no writer in the first century is thought likely.
Peter, do you have a theory as to when the early Christians would have taken Mark's gospel as gospel?
Yeah.
So in other words, I mean, if Mark himself wrote something that he clearly believed was not historically true, although they may have different ideas of what constitute history at the time, but he was clearly writing a literary construction. So how, at what point did Christian communities latch onto this and think this is real history? I mean, it's difficult to what kind of reconstruct that.
I don't think I could possibly answer that really, yeah. Because they're talking about quite a remote time. They're talking about a century before, really, and you know, in our information age, we can't really envisage what a century means in terms of records in the ancient world, when only a small proportion of people were literate anyway. I think Mark's gospel is a great creation, really, and part of its greatness lies in its simplicity. It's written as though it's quite a crude, written quite crudely. Really, I think the mind behind it was very sophisticated. And it's been so influential. Somebody described Mark as the most influential writer ever.
Do you have any view on the hypothesis of Q, the hypothetical gospel sitting behind Matthew and Luke? Do you think that's
I tend not to go with it. I mean, that has been very fashionable, like through the 70s, 80s, and I think it's Michael Gould. Do you know Michael Gould?
Yeah.
He's written a very good book on Q, and he really thinks that that Luke is using Matthew, and Q is really part of Matthew's gospel, and Luke is changing bits both of the narrative and also the Q bits. So the actual idea of a common source, and he's given some very specific examples, very closely argued. I can't remember the title of the book that's in my bibliography there, Michael Gould's book. I think I'm quite convinced if Q existed, if the book Q existed, I think we'd have at least some fragments of it, and we don't. We have lots of fragments of other really weird stuff, but we don't have any of Q, so I don't think it really existed.
Well, it's sustained the careers of a number of
scholars. Yes, and it's still
non-existent.
It's still standard textbook stuff. You can still do your university thesis on Q.
Yeah. And I'm wondering how widespread these ideas are now, Peter. I mean, obviously, this is a minority view. I mean, there are thousands of Christian scholars who kind of dismiss all of these theories as because they obviously they want to believe it, so they'll just dismiss people like you as amateurs, and everyone else who they disagree with, they will dismiss as not real historians and all the rest of it. I'm just wondering if you have a feel for how long will it be before this historical truth, shall we say, we may believe here, will actually kind of seep into academia and the kind of foundations of Christianity, the so-called historical foundations of Christianity, will begin to be eroded in university settings, and therefore that will sort of seep into the family.
Yeah.
I mean, I don't know, is it going to take decades or
yeah,
centuries?
It'll take decades. Yeah. It'll take decades. There are some really authoritative books out now, and inevitably they will make their mark, but and I think it's an expanding field, but I think the university Christian departments are safe for a while.
Mm.
And if we manage to get William Lane Craig here, he'd be happy to debate with him.
No, the thing about
Dean's very good at contacting people. I'm sure he can. He's met William Lane Craig and could probably know him.
Oh dear! Didn't bring my garlic. No, William Lane Craig. You know, he needs to talk to somebody like me because he has a lot of humanists debating, as you know, on YouTube. I expect, and he will trot out these things about the resurrection. And people won't engage him on his own ground. He needs to be engaged on the grounds of Christian scholarship. And of course the humanists are not sufficiently interested to do it, so they make generalised comments and he gets away with murder.
we'll take him on, won't we, do?
Yeah.
Have you had any dialogue with the other Christian sceptics, the Jesus mythicists, about your ideas and battered anything backwards and forwards?
No, I haven't actually. No.
Probably be useful for getting your book a bit more publicity, perhaps, if nothing else.
Probably my competitors.
Yeah.
I was recommending Ken Humphries.
Yeah.
Ken Humphries is quite a good, I just don't like his style, but it's quite a lot of good ideas there. What's his website called?
Jesus Did Not Exist.
Yeah. I mean, I think you just get too obsessed with about whether Jesus exists or not. It's not really the point. You know, there's a lot more to it than that.
Sounds like a pretty big point to me.
Well, no, I mean, people believe in heavenly God, so what's the difference? You know, having an earth, somebody who happened to be on earth for a few years or not, you know. In fact, there's a mythicist, Brody, his name, I think he's a Dominican monk, a friar, is it? And he's a Christian still, even though he's a mythicist. And I think that's, you know, all the other gods are up there, aren't they? So why not Jesus? Did he ever come to earth? Does it really matter? You know?
He's still appearing to people now anyway, so...
On toast.
In person as well. I had lunch with a friend in... Swanage just a few weeks ago, and she was telling me that she knew somebody who'd actually seen Jesus. Jesus had appeared to this person just as you appeared to me now, and he actually touched him. So Jesus is still appearing, making resurrection appearances even now. When I said, did he take a selfie? They just changed the subject. But that would be the obvious
thing. Why didn't Jesus... heal any amputees?
Good question. We're going from don't go now. Keep going for a little bit longer, and then.
Yeah, if I could come up with a general question, if I may. Given the technology of the time and no smartphones, how would a writer back then write about a miracle, for example, coming back from the dead, in a way that will provide evidence that we can now accept it as fact?
I don't quite get that one. If somebody wrote about a miracle, like somebody coming back from the dead, it would be to demonstrate the power of the person who carried out the miracle. And it would probably have some ancient prototype, because in the Old Testament we have Elijah and Elisha, they both raised people from the dead. And Jesus is the new Elijah and the new Elisha and the new Moses, so he could do all the things they could do and even more. So instead of feeding 100 was it? It's 5,000. Instead of raising somebody like Isaiah does from their deathbed, he waits until somebody's stinking in the tomb for 4 days.
But given the technology we have now, if you've created a miracle right there standing for us, and we all videoed it and put it on YouTube, everyone would say, oh, that's fixed, that's been edited, and nobody would believe it, and we would have no way of proving that you duplicated yourself and turned David into another person. We would have no way of proving that, and yet we skeptics want people from back then in the year dot to give us more evidence of what they did because we don't believe them. There seems to be no way of answering that, but it seems we can't do it now.
We just need to understand what the miracle meant. The miracle is an expression of spiritual power and authority. That's what we must understand. It's not a physical thing. It's what somebody has the power to do.
When I went on the Alpha course in Pembury a couple of years ago, I was handed, immediately on entry, I was handed a copy of the New International Version of the Bible. And in the preface it said in quite confident terms that Mark was written, or the Gospels, including Mark, were written in the 50s. And I was astonished that they even sort of went back before 1870.
Yeah.
And I can't quite remember why they said that, but this is what evangelical Christians are reading and believing.
They can say that because there's nothing to say. I mean, if you believe Jesus could actually prophesy, then you could actually say that was so. But sceptical, even Christian sceptical historians, realise that when Jesus foretells the disruption of the temple, it's actually a retrospective thing. I mean, they will admit that it is the case. It doesn't threaten their faith that they admit that. Mm-hmm. But of course, evangelicals are always going to say, they're going to bang it straight as early as possible, you know, and as fresh. But if it's so fresh, why aren't there any names mentioned? Why aren't the authors mentioned? Why don't they speak about you and I instead of all in the third person? It's telling a story from the past, about the past. It's clearly that. Yeah. And so artificial, as you saw with Matthew's Gospel, it's not a narrative at all. It's a sacred arrangement of a pattern to tell a point.
Okay. Any last thoughts or questions, queries? Want any translations of those Latin phrases before we go?
Actually, I've one more. Those ideas you had of Greek writings, some of the Greek writings, and there was some of the stuff in there where maybe you were talking about, from memory, using like crucifixion. And maybe word is wrong. But obviously, Mark, we assume Mark's verse, and Matthew building on that, but there are differences in the stories, and Mark is very similar. Some of the things that you said on that list of prior influences, do some of them just appear in Matthew and Luke? Does that make sense?
Can you give an example of one thing?
From mine, I probably can't. I'm probably waffling. But is it possible? It seems to me like Mark is very, very simple. Yeah.
Yeah.
But those other, when he was doing the links, I'll stop waffling.
Matthew used 90% of Mark,
yeah,
and Luke used 65% of Mark, and they fleshed it out with sayings.
Yeah. And I'm trying to say, but I can't word it very well.
Yeah,
so I'll think about it again and ask you later.
Yeah, okay. You can always email me.
Pete, you haven't actually used the word plagiarism at all in your presentation. But is that a word that you think is useful, or is that really an inappropriate word?
Well, you could say, yes. I mean, in fact, Matthew lifted the whole story from Mark and didn't acknowledge it.
Yeah. Yeah. Mm. But would you say that Mark, if Mark was the original, was that all plagiarism as well? Because all of this stuff is coming from various sources, including Homer.
Well, no. I wouldn't say that, because it's just being creative. I mean, all writers borrow. Okay. All composers borrow. Mm. It's part of the lingua franca, isn't it? So I think it's pretty much an original creation. Some people will say that there was a cross-gospel behind it, but there's no evidence for that. There may have been an earlier writing, but we've got no way at the moment of telling.
Yep, one more.
If I understand you correctly, you've concentrated a great deal on Mark, and you're talking about him being written in first century. Is it possible by then that Christianity was actually becoming more of a separate religion from Judaism, and then the Christian authorities at the time, they needed some sort of authoritarian book on which to base their Christianity, and that was why they then chose Mark? And that's why you've been using him a great deal now.
Yeah, I use Mark because he is the formative gospel. Everybody else depends on him, even John. Yeah, I think you're right that it's the end of the first century. I think the early Christians were Jews, actually, and they went along to the synagogue, and I think there was a great rift towards the end of the century. The date 88 is mentioned. I don't know where I plucked that out from, but very late in the century, in some parts of the world, the Christians actually then were ejected from the synagogues and had to sort of find their own feet. So we're talking about, that's why I've actually put Mark either at the very end of the first, but more likely into the second century.
Is there any indication of the actual number of Christians at any given time early on in, say, the year 100?
Well, they can only make there is in there's in Richard Carey's book, Not the Impossible Faith, there's a whole chapter dealing with numbers, which I'll refer you to. Apparently, numbers would be incredibly small, even up into the second and third centuries. It's only, and even at the time when Constantine was around, I don't think there would be maybe 10%. That's just
Actual concrete numbers, how many? Hundreds? Thousands?
We can't.
I think we were about 12 originally.
I don't agree with that. I think we're more originally than 12.
They all came from different directions. They all they sort of crystallised into one group. They didn't sort of grow like that.
No.
They sort of came the other way, really.
Yeah, so by the year 100, could you put a finger on
that? No, I couldn't possibly put a finger on that. I'd refer you to Richard Carey's article in Not the Impossible Faith.
Yes.
Yeah.
What does he say?
Very low numbers.
Yeah, well,
certainly not the thousand mentioned in Acts of the Apostles. In Acts of the Apostles it said there were 3,000 converted on one day. But then that was not written until about 160 or 170, so how would they know?
Thank you.
Okay, well, maybe take away thought. Next time somebody says to you it's absolute gospel, you may want to take that with a pinch of salt. So, will you please give Peter another big round of applause? And even with my degree in theology and a little bit of biblical scholarship, some of the stuff tonight was quite challenging. So I hope you will, if you're interested, I hope that you will buy Peter's book. There are a couple of copies at the back, and if they're snapped up quickly, then of course you can get them on Amazon. And keep studying, because it's all interesting stuff for humanists to know about the origins of Christianity and to be able to debate authoritatively with evangelical Christians or even Jehovah's Witnesses when they come to the door. Okay, well, our next, just a few notices of our meetings coming up. Our next out-of-the-box dialogue meeting in Wareham, this is a meeting that we have with Christians in the Wareham area once a